be reading from Luke, the 10th chapter, verses 38 through 42. Just a minute, if you want to turn there, or you can read off the screen if you want. We're glad to see you all here. It's no better place to be than be together with brothers and sisters of like faith and worship God. Luke 10, 38 through 42. Now, my glasses, my arms are getting shorter or longer, whichever it is. And he said, 38. Now, it happened as they went that he entered a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she approached him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore tell her to help me." And Jesus answered and said to her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part which will not be taken away from her." Let's sing praises to God.
Number 841. We'll sing the first and third verses.
If the skies above you are gray, you are feeling so blue. If your cares and burdens seem great all the whole day through, there's a silver line that shines in the heavenly land. Look by faith and see, my friend, trust in His promises grand.
We'll sing the first and last verse.
What a song of delight in the city so bright will be wafted in heaven's fair dome. How the ransom will raise happy songs in His praise when all of God's singers get home. When all of God's singers get home, wherever a sorrow will come,
number 137. We'll sing the first and fourth verses of number 137, and then we'll go to God in prayer.
Would you bow with me? Kind and merciful Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this day that you've blessed us with and for the chance that we've had to come and assemble and worship you. Father, we just pray that our worship service tonight will be acceptable to you and uplifting to each of us. Help us to put away the cares of this world and focus on worshiping you in spirit and in truth. We pray that you'll bless Brother Anderson as he brings a message to us this hour. Give him a good recollection of that which he's prepared. We're thankful, Father, for the chance to worship in a country without fear. We pray for our nation. We know that there are things that we are engaged in as a country that we shouldn't be. We know that there are troubles with our country, and we just pray that you'll bless us and help us to be the change, Father, that we want to see in the world. Help us to be shining lights in our community. Help us as we elect leaders to elect people who will look to thee for guidance and for strength, and who will lead our nation in the way that you'd have it to go. Father, we're thankful for the congregation here. We're thankful for the elders and for the deacons who serve. We're thankful, Father, for each member and for the joy that it is to assemble together and worship together. Father, we pray that you'll bless our congregation here and bless all faithful congregations of thy people the world over. Father, we're mindful of those who are sick, those that are afflicted with illnesses and heartaches that we may or may not be aware of. We just pray that you'll comfort them and give them the things that thou knowest they need, and help us to be loving towards each other and helpful towards each other as we have opportunity. Father, we pray that as we leave this place tonight, help us to go out and do good. Help us to love each other and forgive us, Father, when we fail thee. These things we ask in Christ thy Son's name. Amen.
If you want to be marking your books, we'll use number 674 as our song of encouragement. Number 674. And then before the lesson, we're going to sing number 833. We're going to sing the first and last verses of number 833. Let's stand as we sing this song.
There's a message true and glad for the simple and the sad. Bring it out.
It is wonderful indeed to sing these beautiful hymns and to engage in a period of prayer. And we now have an opportunity and a privilege to study God's Word. We invite you to take your Bibles and be turning to 1 Timothy chapter 4, in which our lesson tonight will be based. And while you're doing that, if we have anyone that needs a study guide, Brother Barry is poised back there and ready with those. So he'll come down the aisle, and if you'd like a copy to take some notes on tonight's lesson, please feel free to get his attention and he will get one to you. We're going to be talking tonight about an unpopular subject, exercise. A lot of people put a lot of stock in physical exercise, and it's good for us, we'll admit. Sometimes about the only exercise a lot of us get is walking from the recliner to the table, and that is not always a good thing. Sometimes we become couch potatoes, as it is described, and just eat and lie around on the couch. I dare say that most of you do not do that, and for that you are to be commended. Here's what Paul wrote to the young preacher Timothy in verses 7 and 8 of 1 Timothy chapter 4. But refuse profane and old wives' fables, and exercise yourself rather unto godliness. For bodily exercise profits little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of the life that now is, and of that which is to come. Just to briefly analyze those two verses for a moment, you'll notice in the context that Paul had been talking about things that would be taught that were wrong, and how that people would speak lies and hypocrisy. People would depart from the faith in verse 1. There would be seducing spirits and doctrines of demons that would be at work. And he talked about the seriousness of that situation. Paul was trying to prepare Timothy for the ordeal that was sure to come. There would be problems in Timothy's life that he would encounter and face as a preacher of the gospel. And he encourages Timothy to remember the basic fundamentals of the gospel and to put brethren in remembrance of those things in verse 6. And then to contrast that, he said, but there are going to be profane and old wise fables. A fable is a myth, something that is in the realm of legends that are not grounded in fact. And so he said, those types of things are going to be out there. You're going to be confronted with them. Refuse those. Do not turn to those things as the substance of what you preach and teach. Just discard them and concentrate on preaching to the two people the truth. And do not allow those to become the controlling factor in your life. Be sure that you exercise yourself unto godliness. The word rather there is inserted. Exercise thyself rather unto godliness. That's the idea, clearly, though that word is supplied by the translators because it's in italics. Just exercise yourself unto godliness. But as compared to those things, don't pursue those things, those fables and old wives' tales. Just concentrate on God's Word and doing what it teaches you to do. Then he points out that bodily exercise profits little. He doesn't say that it is totally void of value. He says there may be a degree of profitability about it, but it has to do primarily with the flesh, with this life, and so on. But he said godliness is profitable unto all things. And then he said it has promise of the life that now is. That would be the Christian life that we're presently living. And of that which is to come. That is, godliness reaches beyond this life in its importance, influence, and reach. It's very, very important. It's the most critical thing in the life of any individual to be a godly person, to live like God wants you to live, and to seek to be what He wants you to be. We're all aware of the fact that physical exercise in this country is big business, and even throughout the world. There are all kinds of things. You know, a really good pair of walking shoes can be very expensive. And a lot of people buy high-dollar running shoes. Oh, you got to have a certain type of shoe. And there are various companies that push their brand names and tell of the benefits of those. And you know, if those shoes could make you run as fast and jump as high as they say they do, everybody ought to have them, shouldn't they? And that's what they want us to think. You got to have a pair of those shoes in order to be, the in crowd. We have so much apparel, so many types of clothing. It has to be matching. I mean, it's fashion attire that has been designed to appeal to people, you know. I mean, we have a good number of runners in the Run for Don. But it always amazes me. I come in my jeans most of the time, and boy, I mean, there's some flashy dressed people. They're matching outfits and all of that, because I don't run, I just walk. But that's exercise too, as we'll see in our study tonight. But you have state-of-the-art gyms in this country, all kinds of weights, all kinds of things that will help you exercise muscles that most of us do not even know we have. But, you know, that's because it's big business. There are exclusive membership clubs that are devoted to exercising physically. And I wonder sometimes if we haven't reached the point where we're a lot like the ancient Greeks, where we worship the physical body. It has become a god to a lot of people. And nothing wrong with being in relatively good health, but you can be in outstanding physical condition and still die. I mean, that happens a lot. I heard not long ago of an individual that run for, you know, for many, many years and was just in excellent physical condition and died of a massive heart attack just like that. You know, everybody thought he had one of the healthiest hearts anywhere, but he gave out. You can do that and be in extreme physical condition when you're maybe in your 80s, but eventually all of us are going to die, aren't we? You may have heard the old Johnny Cash line where somebody asked him what he did back in his heyday. Now, this was not during his rough and tumble days, but when he was really, really popular, somebody asked him what he did for exercise if he jogged. And with that deep monotone or that deep baritone voice, he said, "No, I've been the pallbearer for too many of my jogging friends." And, he had a different take on it. So I don't know what he did for exercise. But Paul's message alludes to two types of exercise. We briefly mentioned them, but let's look at them a little bit in greater detail. He said, exercise yourself unto godliness. The word exercise is from a Greek term that literally means to train up. So we talk about training. That's included in this word. But it's used in reference to spiritual exercise. Exercise unto, that is, with a view to. We would say, in view of godliness. You know, physical exercise is done with a view to being in excellent physical condition. All the muscles well toned, all the body proportioned as it's supposed to be, you know. Well, this exercise of which Paul is speaking has a different goal, a different vision, if you please. It is done unto godliness. The purpose of this exercise is to be a godly person. To be godly before our Almighty God. This same word, exercise, appears in a couple of passages in the book of Hebrews that rather interesting. You remember in chapter 5 of Hebrews, Paul talks to the Hebrew Christians about their need to have developed and grown and matured in Christ. And some of them were in a state where they needed someone to teach them again the first principles of the oracles of God. Well, he talks about having your senses exercised to know good from evil. The word exercise in that passage is the same one that is used here. We need to train up our senses to be able to discern between good and evil, to know right from wrong. And the only way we can do that is by exercising ourselves unto godliness, delving into His Word, studying His Word, and coming to know more of His will. A little bit farther over in the book of Hebrews, in chapter 12, there's a rather lengthy discussion by the writer about the chastening of the Lord, how He chastens us because we're His children, He loves us. And just as a physical earthly father who loves his children will discipline them and chasten them when they do wrongs in order to correct them, he said, there is the chastening of the Lord by which you are exercised. And again, the word is the same as it is in 1 Timothy 4, showing us that the difficulties through which we go in life can often exercise us in that it trains us to be more godly. We need to encounter those things with a view unto godliness. How can I view this? What kind of an attitude do I need to take toward this situation in my life so that I can be more like God wants me to be? Am I going to respond in hate and anger and frustration? Or am I going to bend my will to the will of God and allow this situation to help me to be a better person? That's a very important thought to contemplate. So the word is used a couple of times in the book of Hebrews, and then Peter talks about it in 2 Peter 2:14, when he talks about some people who are exercised in covetousness. Same word is used, but here is a negative use of it, if you please. They are being trained and brought to a point in time to be covetous. That's not what God wants. That's the very opposite of godliness, isn't it? But the word is used in both senses. Now, the bodily exercise that is mentioned in this passage is from a Greek term from which we get our word gymnasium. And it is a reference to gymnastic exercises. There are a lot of people who are into that today as well. And the exercises that you do, the stretching and all of the things that are involved in gymnastics can be helpful beneficially. And that was done, that is physically. But the Greeks were involved in that heavily, and I'm sure the Romans were too, because the Greek culture was still influencing the general populace in Paul's day. There were games in which they engaged, very similar to our Olympics today. But notice that the first type of exercise is said to be profitable. That word comes from a Greek term that means useful. And you'll find that in 2 Timothy 3:16 in reference to the Scriptures. They are profitable for instruction and correction and so on. Same word. They are useful to that end. And then in Titus 3 verse 8, the term is used also, the same Greek term. Now, the second type, the physical exercise, he said, profits little. Oligos is the word. And it has the meaning of being small, few, or short. That is, you come up short in reference to godliness by simply thinking that the only exercise that's important is physical exercise. You know, gymnastic exercises might make you a good gymnast, but does it make you godly? Does it help you to be a child of God? Is that the primary focus of it? Oh, no. Primary focus of it is competition. Being the best in whatever it is you're doing. That's the goal. But the exercise unto godliness brings us to God, doesn't it? We can come up short. We need to be concerned about pleasing God. You know, there are a lot of exercises in which we engage today that really are not that beneficial. And maybe there's a little bit of a comical twist to some of these, but we need to stop and think about them seriously, because I think sometimes we get caught up in these things. Have you ever heard of climbing the walls? People talk about just climbing the walls. You know, I'm in such a state of mind, I'm just climbing the walls. I've known of people being sick and on medication and maybe being... I remember one time Barbara was put in a small hospital room. They thought she had something contagious. And I came in to see her and she said, "I am climbing the wall." You know, I mean, it's just... everything's just closing in on me. That's not a real good exercise in which to engage, is it? We use that word... sort of symbolically and figuratively to talk about being in that state of mind. But sometimes people do that. It's not really beneficial exercise. And then what about dragging your heels? You ever heard that expression? Now, capitalize all these primary words. Climbing, that's an exercise. You know, there are even events that people do in training for certain sports. They climb walls. If you're in the military, I believe old Gomer Pyle had to climb a wall or two, didn't he, when he was in the Marines? It was always comical to watch him attempt to do that. So then we drag our heels. We don't want to get the job done. We're not willing to just get up and get with it and get it done. We drag our heels. And sometimes we grasp at straws. There are a lot of people who grasp at straws. They just try to find some little something to hold on to keep them from doing what they know they need to do. It's said that a drowning man will grab at a straw because it's the last chance, we think, and in order to survive. Sometimes people skip their meals. People tell us that are into diet and all of that. It's not a good idea to do that. And if we're going to maintain good physical health, we need to eat regularly. One of the things I remember about my father, he basically throughout his life, he was in a routine where he ate at the same time every day. He ate breakfast very early. So he would always want to eat lunch or dinner, as we called it, between 11 and 12. And then the evening meal would always come in the summertime, sometimes close to sundown because we were working in the fields late. But he always was on that routine. And eating healthy, you know, and he didn't eat the fare that some people have, but it was good, nutritious food, most of it grown on the farm. But he was in that routine. And now I find myself, you know, maybe most mornings I'll eat breakfast at the same time, but some mornings I do not. And sometimes I just totally skip lunch, and that's not good. And sometimes then we eat supper, the evening meal, most of the time about the same time, but a lot of times 8 or 9, 10 o'clock at night. And that just doesn't go over very well. So we need to eat regularly scheduled meals, we know. We need to do that spiritually too, don't we? Think of all the people that skip spiritual meals, miss services and all that. It's not a good exercise. What about spinning your wheels? A lot of people are engaged in that exercise. They're just doing the same thing, just sitting there spinning their wheel, never going anywhere. I see some of these marks on the highway, and you can tell that somebody's backed out of their drive, and boy, they have taken off, and a lot of that Goodyear rubber's laying there on the road. And you know, somebody else is probably buying their tires, or they were drunk and were mad, wanting to show out, or whatever, you know. The spinning wheels will not get you anywhere. Sometimes when I'm mowing the grass, got a lawnmower with too wide a deck for the width of the wheels. So as a result, the deck digs in the ground on one side or the other if you're mowing where the ground is uneven. And you know what happens if you mow much grass. The deck catches on the ground and your tires start spinning. And you're just sitting there. You're wondering what's... I've had to take my four-wheeler and pull my lawnmower out two or three times because it was so wedged in to the ground. You raise your deck up all the way and still sometimes it'll kick. But you're just spinning your wheels. You're not going anywhere. And there are a lot of people spiritually who are in that condition. What about jumping the gun? We do that sometimes too, don't we? We jump to conclusions that are unwarranted. We just make the decision that something is a certain way when it's not that way at all. You may remember, some of you may remember the old story, made its rounds many years ago, about the couple who were sitting in their living room one day, and the husband looked out the window and said, "Well, there goes old Jim Jones with that woman that he's in love with." And his wife jumped up and ran to the window and looked out. She turned around and slapped him on the side of the head and said, "Well, you're crazy. That's his wife." You have to think about that a minute. That's his wife. Jumped to a conclusion, didn't she? And we need to be careful about that. Sometimes we pass the buck. That's not a good exercise. We pass our responsibility on to someone else. Passing the buck is not good. We visited the home of Harry Truman several years ago in Missouri and saw the replica of the Oval Office that's there in the museum. And sure enough, there it was on his desk. The buck stops here. I'm not passing it any further. You know, I'm responsible. And we all have responsibilities in our life, and we can't pass that off on anybody else. Sometimes people push their luck. You know, you can gain exercise or gain bodily strength by pushing. The story is told of a man to whom the Lord spoke and said, "There is that rock out there in your field. I want you to push on it every day." And so the man arose the next morning, pushed on the rock. He did, went forth the second morning, and he did it morning after morning for several years. And so he talked to the Lord and said, "You know, I've been pushing on that rock all these years, and I haven't been able to move it a single inch. Why? What is the use? What is the benefit of this?" And the Lord said, "My son, I didn't tell you to move the rock. I told you to push on the rock. Look at your arms, how strong they are. Look at your back, the muscles you have and the strength that you have. Look at your legs. You are in fine physical condition because you have obeyed me. I wanted you to become strong. I didn't want you to push the rock. I didn't want you to move the rock. Just wanted you to push it." We have so many instances in our lives when if we would simply push, we would get stronger. We would build ourselves up spiritually instead of giving up. But some people push their luck by engaging in activities that they already know what the conclusion is going to be, don't they? We need to avoid that type of pushing. What about stretching the truth? A lot of people exercise in stretching the truth, don't they? We have to be careful about that. The truth is fragile. If we begin trying to stretch it, sooner or later it'll break. Let's just simply let the truth be the truth. That's what Jesus said, wasn't it? Let your yea be yea and your nay, nay. And then there are those who just run amok. Running amok is, you know, having no purpose, no sense of direction. I used to have a teacher. I never really understood it because I didn't know the story of Hector, I guess. He said, running like Hector's horse, running in every direction at the same time. But there are people who have too much time on their hands anymore, and they're running and doing things that they don't really need to be doing. I wonder sometimes when I look at all these protesters that sometimes get out and the mobs that have been observed in the past several months and last few years, I wonder if they have a job. I wonder if they have nothing more to do than what they're doing. You know, a lot of people don't have the time to do those things because they're busy working and trying to provide for families. That's something maybe for us to think about. And be careful about exercising yourself by patting yourself on the back. You know, you can hurt yourself patting yourself on the back so much. A lot of times we do that, but that's not a really good exercise to develop spirituality. And finally, running down others. That's not a worthwhile activity. You know, we don't need to try to make ourselves look better by running down other people. That's not the way it works, is it? We must be the right kind of person ourselves. But let me tell you some profitable exercises. Number one, walking. It is said that walking is still the best overall exercise. But some people don't have time to walk for an extended period of time, so they run. And many times they end up with knee problems, have to go and have surgery and all that. But walking is sort of a gentle exercise on the body. Well, it's interesting that God uses that term many times. Young in his concordance says that walking means to go on habitually. To go on habitually. You just keep on making progress. May not be as fast as the person who is running in a speedy way. But the Bible uses this term in several different connections. Number one, there's walking with God. Remember Enoch? Back in the book of Genesis, chapter 5, verse 24. In chapter 6, it is said of Noah that he walked with God too. Both of these men are described as walking with God. There's with whom we are to walk. Then we read also of walking by faith. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 7. And other passages use that statement. Walking by faith. And then Paul talked in Ephesians 5, verse 2, about walking in love. And that context will show you what has been said many times over the years. There is a lot of difference in walking in love and walking in lust. And if you read a few verses after Ephesians 5, verse 2, you will find Paul talking about people who walk in lust. He has just said, walk in love. So we can learn from that passage that walking in love is not walking in lust. There's a lot of difference in the two. He talks about fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, and so on in the latter verses. After he has already reminded those brothers and sisters to walk in love. We know that love is pure when we read 1 Corinthians 13. So walking in love is pursuing and engaging in those things that are good and pure and holy and godly, and all those things that are mentioned in Philippians chapter 4. Walk in the Spirit. That is, follow the direction in which the Spirit of God leads us. The Spirit teaches us through the Word. Sometimes people will say, well, I just felt that God led me this way, when what they're doing is clearly in violation of what God's Word teaches. The Spirit isn't leading them. Well, a Spirit is, but not the Spirit. One of those spirits that Paul talks about in 1 Timothy 4, verse 1, that he describes as seducing spirits. Now, those spirits will lead you where you don't need to go. When you walk with God, you follow the direction that is given by the Spirit of God, which is revealed in the Word of God. So there are four things that are said about walking. We're told with whom to walk, and we're told how to walk. Walking is good exercise. But then we're told, too, to run the race that is set before us, aren't we? Hebrews 12, verse 1. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Paul in Philippians 2:16 talked about running that race. Talked about running well. 1 Corinthians 9, verses 24 through 26. He tells us about that we must run, and that we must run according to the rules. You may have heard of the race several years ago in California, that the course had been laid out. But there, you came to a certain point where it looked like maybe you needed to go this way. I believe it was to the right. But there was a man from that area who knew the track really well. He had run it before. And he said, this way, and went to the left. And there was only a handful of people that followed him. All the other runners were disqualified because they did not run the course as it had been laid out. Only he and the few that followed him were recognized at the completion of the race because they did not run the race laid out to be run. There are a lot of people who are running spiritually, but they're running in the wrong direction. The race that is set before us denotes that it has been laid out. I think that corresponds to the way of holiness of which Isaiah spoke. And he said, you know, anyone is able to observe it, to see it, to know it, and to follow it. It's the way of holiness that is so well defined that you can know whether or not you're walking and running the right way. A lot of people lift weights in doing exercises, don't they? And building themselves up, you know, you can tell a fellow that's been lifting weights. I mean, you just know by looking at him. There's some people in Jackson County that have come in and put a gym up there. And I see those guys occasionally at Helen's Restaurant. You know they're weightlifters. I mean, it shows. Their arms are massive. Their arms are larger than my legs. And just, you know, I mean, they're so tremendously built. But I just go ahead and eat my beans and taters and let them eat whatever they're eating. But they seem like nice fellas. I don't know them that well. But people lift weights to build themselves up physically. What can we do in order to build ourselves up spiritually? I would suggest we could do some lifting. Remember Galatians 6 and verse 2? Paul tells us to bear one another's burdens and fulfill the law of Christ in so doing. And then just a couple of verses later, in verse 5, he said, let every man bear his own burden. So there's two things that we can lift. We can lift the burdens of others. We can lift our own burdens. That is, fulfill our responsibilities. Accept the tasks that we have to do and do them. And we will be strengthened spiritually in so doing. So there are weights that we can lift and build ourselves up spiritually. You know, you've seen people doing exercises, doing the squats and the knee bends and all that. I would suggest to you that that's a good spiritual exercise too. Frequent kneeling in prayer will help us spiritually. We need to spend more time on our knees in prayer to God. Now, I'm not saying that that is the only prayer posture. There are some people who probably might never be able to kneel and pray because they may be flat of their back or whatever. But we do know from what the Bible teaches that it is a very reverential posture to assume when praying. And people have been kneeling in prayer for a long time. There are people that are described in the Bible as praying, having fallen evidently flat on their face. There are people who pray in the Bible standing. But we need to think of the symbolism there, and the figurative idea of kneeling in prayer, our minds kneeling before God in subjection. Pray without ceasing. 1 Thessalonians 5:17. Jesus taught men by his parables that they ought always to pray and not to faint. Luke 18:1. Continue instant in prayer. Romans 12:12. Continue in prayer. Colossians 4:2. Oh, so many passages emphasize the importance of kneeling in prayer. And when we exercise, we often bend, don't we? I'm going to suggest that we bend over the Bible. We need to spend more time bent over the Bible. Studying God's Word diligently, not just casually reading a few words, but really thinking about what it teaches. Take that passage that we've used as our text tonight and do much as we've done, looking at the words, emphasizing each word. Someone suggested one time, let's emphasize Psalm 23:1. The Lord is my shepherd. Try reciting that sometime and emphasizing one word at a time. Start with thee and go all the way to shepherd. Emphasize each word in succession. Think about it. Think about the meaning. There's only one Lord, so he's the Lord. The Lord. What does that word mean? He's my master. The Lord is. Not was, not can be, not may be, but he is. He is my. Denotes the person. The Lord is my shepherd. What are the attributes of a shepherd? You know, think about shepherd. It's so rich to study the Bible in that way. The Bereans did it daily, Acts 17:11, and we're admonished along with Timothy to study to show ourselves approved unto God. What kind of exercise are you engaged in? Are you pursuing those exercises that won't benefit you and might even condemn you? Or are you pursuing those that will build you up in the faith and render you more godly? We commend this lesson to you for you to think about and study. If you're not a New Testament Christian, you need to obey the gospel tonight. As a penitent believer, you can confess your faith in Jesus as God's Son and be baptized into him for the remission of your sins. If you're an erring child of God, you can come back home tonight, be restored to your first love, and by being faithful unto God, live with him forever in heaven when life is over. If you're subject, we invite you to come as together we stand and sing.
There's a great day coming, a great day coming, there's a great day coming by and by. When the saints and sinners shall be parted by and left, are you ready for that day to
Turn to number 452. The table's been left prepared for anyone who did not have a chance to take the Lord's Supper this morning. If you'll come to the front seat here as we sing the first verse of number 452, you'll be waiting on it. Night with ebon pinion brooded o'er the veil, all around was silent, save the night wind's wail. When Christ, the man of sorrows, in tears and sweat and blood, prostrate garden, raised his voice to God.
Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this bread, which represents the body of Christ that hung upon the cross. As these partake, we ask that they partake with the manner well pleasing unto thee. In Christ's name, amen. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this cup, the fruit of the vine, which represents the blood that Christ shed upon the cross for our sins. As these partake, we ask that they partake with the manner well pleasing unto thee. In Christ's name, amen. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the ability to work and earn a portion of this world's goods. We're thankful for the money that will be brought into this facility, in this congregation, that is being put to good use and each and every day of this church, that as it goes on and prospers. And I ask that these will give with a cheerful heart for our Christ's name, amen.
Closing song, Johnny, will be number 40, 40. We are grateful for your presence tonight. We have a couple of updates on the sick. Carol told me that Brother Charles Williamson, I think, went home today. So we're thankful for that. And continue to remember him in our prayers, because he's going to be having some kind of an implant that he'll have to wear for 3 years, I believe you said, Carol, right? So for his heart to be monitored. And remember Reese's parents, the Reasonovers. Let's remember both of them. And they were injured in an accident involving, I guess, the storms and so on, and surgery had to be performed on her mom. Let's keep in mind all of our sick list and remember them in our prayers from time to time as we pray. Elders, deacons, preachers meeting will be Wednesday night, so copies of the agenda are available back there. Remember to sign up for the fair booth. If you can help work that booth, we would appreciate it. And our annual Friday night singing will be August the 5th, and we're all looking forward to that. We'll be at camp beginning next Sunday through the following Saturday, so be sure to keep us in your prayers and that we'll all be safe and have a good week of Bible study. It'll be profitable to all of us. This week, Vacation Bible School is going on at Montrose, so remember that if you would, and if you have an opportunity to attend, please do. Let's remember Brother W.A., he's not started dialysis yet, but he will be, and we'll be talking about some of us maybe helping him get from his dialysis appointments on occasion, and we'll be talking more about that on Wednesday night, Lord willing, in our meeting. If you want or need some plastic cups, there's a pack out there from, I believe it's Cash and Carry. They brought a whole carton of plastic cups. And if you need some, just take a packet of those home with you and utilize them as you need them. And we had been meaning to announce that, and maybe it's already been announced. I left a note, and I'm sure it has been announced. But the Whitleyville Church of Christ also is having a meeting July 17th, beginning going through the 20th. Brother Keith Parker will be preaching up there, and they have invited all of us to come. Anything further need to be announced? Appreciate your presence. Let's be back Wednesday night as we continue our summer series. We hope you'll be here. And I need to mention, too, that we had teachers meeting this afternoon, or a Bible curriculum meeting, and Jeremy is going to be discussing that with the combined adult classes next Sunday morning. And we're excited about it. We'll all be kind of on the same page when we get this in place. It's going to save us a lot on buying material, too. We appreciate his and Michael's and everybody else, Justin, and all of them have been involved in it, and all those that are helping write the material and put it together. Really a good thing. So let's keep that in mind and be praying for our Bible study work, too. Let's stand for the closing song and pray.
Shall we pray? Our glorious Heavenly Father, we humbly lower our heads to you as we approach your throne of grace this evening. Father, we are thankful for the time that we've had to assemble together, to fellowship with one another, to worship you, and to sing praises to you. Father, we pray this has been done in spirit and in truth. Father, we pray that as we can continue to live our lives, Lord, that we will do everything that we can to love you with all our heart, soul, and mind, Father, and that we will do everything we can to love those that are around us as well. Father, be with those that have been mentioned here tonight, those that are on our minds as well, Lord, that are sick at this time. Father, we pray that they are able to be provided the best care by the doctors and nurses around them, and that we can do everything we can to encourage and uplift them. Be with us as we depart from here. Father, we pray that your will be done in all things. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.